Do I have to say it? is connected to the internet.
Yes.
And a cold wallet isn't.
Yes, that's right. And I was thinking about it, but what I think even is that you can say is that your private keys are connected to the internet. And a cold store, because encrypted as well, for example, when you use a hardware wallet, you also use a web app, right? But your private keys are on the device. They're never connected directly on the internet, and they always remain on the device.
For me, that's a clearer split.
You agree?
Yeah.
Yes. So another differentiation is we have software wallets. So those are wallets that you download or apps on your mobile. So and it's a software client basically you download. You have web wallets. It can be different things like whatever. You have basically you can access them from each and every device. Right? So you make a connection to a server. You have paper wallets. Hank mentioned that already in detail. It's very safe, but the disadvantage is that for I think for a lot of people it's not very practical. Don't want to send it. And the other thing is you always have to put your keys on online as well the moment you want to send it. And so you don't have that encryption then. Oh, sorry, I forgot something. So who uses a hardware wallet here in the audience? Please type in. I want to see it. Thank you. Okay. A lot of people. Okay. Most users. So I hope I still can tell you something new. Let's say 2/3. Going to the hardware wallet. We talked about that. The recommendation is to use a hardware wallet instead of a mobile phone or a desktop. It's a safer solution. What devices are you using? People who are using a hardware wallet. So we have, I would like to focus on the most important ones. We have a Trezor, we have a Ledger Nano S. I will show them to you. That you can have so much money on such small devices. It's ideal. For kettle growers. This is a Trezor. It has a screen, small screen. And we have a Ledger Nano, that's this one. It's like a USB key. You also have a screen, but it has its limitations and it works a bit in a different way. The thing is, all these hardware wallets have the same, I would say, technology, and they use the BIP39 and BIP44. Improvement proposals, but the user interface, the way you use it can be a bit different. So, and that's also my problem, because if I want to give a live demo, then I have to show them all. So what I would like to show is just how the process is, and how they implement it might be a bit different. You have also have a Ledger Blue, which is, yeah, I would say it looks a bit like a tablet. To me, it doesn't add a lot of value, except that it's much more expensive, which is sure we'll show you later. It looks cool, for sure, for sure. You have KeepKey. I checked yesterday and they were available again, but I had a problem just ordering them in the last couple of months. So I don't have the KeepKey yet. Then I have a digital BitBox. It's a Swiss one, I think might be new to a lot of people. The difference is it has no screen. But it has an integrated SD card, which also makes the difference different from these other ones. I'll show that later. It's your seat, for example, which you can only store right now on paper. You can also store it on that SD card, which is encrypted then. But you can also write down the seat again if you would like to do it. And it has, yeah, it has a bit more functionality. And you agree or not? because you're the technical expert. Okay. Then there are someone using an air gap computer. Now, the thing is, it's quite complicated to do that correctly. But people with, let's say, where would it be? a few thousand bitcoins, and with some technical feeling, probably we'll go for that, which is just a computer which is never connected to the internet. But there are all kinds of rules, so we won't touch that there. And there are some other devices as well, but I think these four ones are probably the main ones. And you should see a lot of people, I think Ledger Nano is very popular now. Now, when you want to buy one of the things probably that can be imported is which coins can you store in it. I think probably the Ledger has post altcoins as well now. The others, the Trezor, the arts about to say, they all have Bitcoin, and now they have Bitcoin Cash, Ether, Ethereum, and Ethereum Classics. And they also have the ERC20 coins, which are the ones running on the Ethereum network. And there are a few other ones. This list will be expanded over time. They're always developing it, but this is the state as well. Another thing is pricing. Now let's go to the economics, because probably some people want to buy it. Issue number one, at least I think that improved a bit, was availability, because most of them were this year, always out of stock. So you didn't have a lot of choice. Most people were already really very happy when they could get them. The Trezor, just have a look at the prices. What I would suggest is always buy them directly from the manufacturer. It's also a security risk if you buy it from Amazon or whatever. Maybe it's not such a big risk, but I think it's just better. It's the most secure option. Check availability. Of course, if you have, for example, the key, which doesn't look that expensive, but you get the duties and taxes and shipping, might be a bit slower as well. Digital Bitbox, not that expensive. And you see Ledger Blue, it's, if you're really poised, looking for something posh, then you might want it, but it doesn't add a lot. Pricing. Okay, then you order them, and then the happy moment comes and you receive them. I have them here as well. This is a Ledger package. This is the Digital Bitbox. And you have to Trezor. What you should do is just check if it's complete. Now, is it the original one? There are seals on it. Are they unbroken? And anything else, you're ready to go. Afterwards, you plug in your device. When you plug in, you need some software to run it. There's a difference between Trezor, for example. Works by a web interface for Bitcoin. I just mentioned it because, not in detail, because there are too many options in here. And when you want to deal with Ethereum, you, for example, have to use my Ether wallet. When you look, Ledger is a bit different because they really developed for a lot of the main currencies specific Chrome-based extensions or apps, in fact, they are. So you have a Bitcoin app, you have an Ethereum app, you have the straightest app even, we start the thing. And the other thing is, the installation is going via Ledger, an app called Ledger Manager. For Trezor, you do the installation and the setup via Trezor I.O. Digital Bitbox is again different. There you have a native software client, so you have the Bitbox software which you download, and then you can do the setup. Setting up your device. Now you start with some basic settings, which you give it the name, you start the things, not very spectacular, nothing spectacular. And then, like Trezor, they don't have updated firmware, so you start with a firmware update, which goes via that interface. It's quite simple. You always have the option, some people would want to do that, is to wipe, because it comes with, the original seed. You can always wipe the seed that's shipped with and just create a new one. That's all. And then you go to, I think, and this is really the most important part, is to back up your seed. Hank already told you, these are all high logical deterministic wallets, and they're based, you have that seed, and from that seed you can create all your private and public keys. This one you have to store. It's 24, for all these devices you have 24 words. You write that down, I would suggest. As I say, you can make a paper backup, and then the 3-2-1 rule is important, for example. And the three copies, and what they mean with three copies is the original plus two other ones, store it on two locations, and or on two different media, sorry, and store one of those copies at least offsite. With that seed, you can always restore when you look, for example, because somebody knows if it's a problem if you will lose your device. That's dramatic. What will happen? If you lose it. Yeah, you can just restore it if you have a PIN ID, that's the next one. You have a PIN, and a PIN is specific for your device. So, and the other thing is, the PIN is set up in such a way that by every wrong input, you get to the power 2 and timing is increasing, which means that after 20 inputs, you already need to wait, I think, for 6 days. After 30 wrong inputs, 17 years. So you can't do a brute force attack on the pin, is impossible. So once, when you lose it, you just have your seed and you can restore it. With that seed, you can restore, for example, from a Trezor to a Ledger. That's not really a problem, apart from that there might be some, what I told you already before, user interface differences. But you can also go, for example, to a Mycelium and another web wallet and restore your funds there. So there's no problem. That's also the security problem, of course, because that was mentioned already, should you have your seed in one place. But that's important. I'll come back to that in a moment, because that's where the passphrase comes in. Another option is what some people do as well, is they don't want to store or keep any paper. And what you can also do is make exact copies, so what you do is you wipe your original seed and you make a restore from another device. So you have, let's say, set one, or let's say two devices with exactly the same server. That's what I personally prefer. And you can also, because it's also cross-compatible, you can also do that on different brands, for example. So in case you lose one, you always have the other one. You can do it with three as well, or a combination. To me, that's quite convenient, also with making firmware backups, because if something goes wrong, then I don't have to do the whole seed restore, and you just have a second device, and you can test it already if it works. Same with chain splits, I'll show it.
Okay,
yes.
I understand it right, so you can have same thing, you have exactly the same device, same seed, same.
If
I ruin this one and I make a mistake,
no problem.
I just have,
for example, for everything, I have two Trezors and two Ledgers, and they have exactly the same setup. The only difference is the PIN number, because the PIN number is specific for your device. So if you restore, for example, if you forget your PIN number as well, you can always restore based on your seed, because then you enter a new PIN number, so that's not a problem. That's a problem later where I'll show you in the past first. And the same you can do with a Ledger and a Trezor, for example. So they are exactly the same point. Okay, that's multiple hardware wallets. So with the same C phrase, that's what they need then. They also, I'll come back on that next, it's the same passphrase, because I'll show that later, with a different passphrase, you get a different wallet. What I always would recommend is, take all your stuff from time to time and check it again, if it works, if you still remember the codes, if you have the paperwork, because at least I tend to forget many things, and it's getting worse every year. You see, I keep several copies, but keep them distributed, not at one spot, preferably. Just a sidestep, a strong pin number. I think you know this, I don't have to mention. Do not repeat numbers, do not use a sequence, and make it as long as possible. For these devices now, you can have 8 digits, I think even for the decimal 10. But at least what I do is I always use 4, but I now have 8 for them. It's just, you know, an extra step of being secure. Then the main thing, because I think this is an important one, and I forgot about that also for a long time, I didn't do it because I was too lazy, is the passphrase. Who's using a passphrase in their hardware wallet? The people who are. There are 3? No? The reason why I started, I told you I'm lazy, where I started is because there was an issue with Trezor this month. I don't know who heard about it, because at least the rumor was, or someone claimed, that he hacked a Trezor by physically attacking it. So disassembling it, and one or the other way, I don't know how, he could recover the seed. Okay.
Yeah, by opening it up.
Yes.
Exactly the right
second
during the start of this.
Okay, that's what happened. But they deny it, but okay. But nevertheless, there was a firmware update now, which solved the issue. But there is also the passphrase. With the passphrase activated, it wouldn't be a problem anyhow. Because what the passphrase in fact is, it's more like the 25th word. And where the PIN number is device specific, the passphrase is wallet specific. So that means that with the 25th word, you create a completely different wallet. So when you now, for example, don't have that, it's not activated when your device and you define the passphrase, you log in with the passphrase, then you won't see your funds anymore because it's in a different wallet. The advantage is that you can, the physical attacks won't be a problem any longer. It's also, of course, a protection in case of theft or of your recovery seed. And it also, because I had that same problem, is, you know, should I cut my seed into pieces and store it in different locations? But if you have a passphrase, it's not really an issue. And of course, never store the passphrase together with the seed, because it won't work. So use different locations. And the recommendation is that you should have a passphrase that you just can recall from mind, that you don't write it down anywhere. And then it's safe as well. So you might have, you know, if somebody even finds your, for example, Trezor or your hardware wallet, plus your recovery sheet, still nothing can happen as long as they don't have the passphrase, even if they pin number as well.
Would you add the passphrase later to the device?
Yes, that's no problem. That's what I did as well. What you only need to do then is, I'll come to that. What you also can do is create hidden wallets with it, because the I think also, which probably will become more important in time, is, of course, you have so-called doing point situations where people know you have a lot of Bitcoin, you can get into trouble and they can force you to give your PIN number and to open your wallet. So if you have several wallets with several passphrases, you can just send them into the, different wallets, and they won't see you have, for example, one wallet with just spending money and the real main amount. The main fund is in another wallet. And you can, with Trezor, you can create many of them, as many as one. With the Ledger, you can create 2 permanently, but also temporary ones. So then you have to basically follow the procedure, and it's not very practical. So. But the other thing is, what you might expect in the future, is that at border control, you might and you have a device, in particular in the United States, probably they might be the first one, that they want you to open, your device and show what funds power on there. And then you can use this as well. You just, you know, open it, and once you have opened it, you comply with all regulations, so they can do anything. And there is no way for them to tell that there are other wallets or other passphrases on your device. And the same, of course, with criminals, they can't see it. Likely, that's impossible to see. But that's also an important reason to activate it. And yeah, I mean, I don't have a lot of money on it, but I passed with all this stuff, also the border control, but I already felt that doesn't feel really comfortable, because they can do whatever they want. They can also confiscate it, and that happened already in the past. Then you lose it, of course, but you can restore it. Just to show you. So, this basically is one. So, this is related to your wallet specific, and just without a PIN, you can restore everything. The PIN number is just for your device. So, can you please recall just before, what your question was? And what you're asking? Do you have a question? Yeah, me too. Yeah, we are really old. You're probably one of the oldest. Yeah. We passed 50, yeah, that's right. Oh, yeah, sorry. Yeah. That's quite embarrassing. Well, okay. We have to excuse. Yes, you can do that. That's still a problem. What you should do then is because you have a new passphrase, and probably you want to have your, your core amount, your main amount on that new wallet you create, and you just have to send it to your new, to the new addresses, which are part of the wallet. And then you can also create other wallets. Yeah. Okay, the restore procedure, I think that's clear already, is just when you have your seed, I told that already, and you have the passphrase, you just can restore it on different devices, but also on web wallets or software wallets. And you enter the open code. Okay, then just when you start, people maybe don't know, just keep this short. So I'll just take the Trezor as an example, and as I say, with the ledger it works a bit different. With the digital bitbox, you have just a user interface on your computer, which is different as well, because you don't have a screen. But usually, you just connect your device to your computer. Personally, I never use my mobile phone, but you know, it's just a feeling. To me, it feels insecure. Also because, and I don't know if you heard that story from John McAfee. I won't say he's reliable, but at least it impressed me. He told that more than 6 million mobile phones are already hacked, basically waiting for me, the big day to take all the funds. What they do is they check, that's what he said, all the apps that are installed on these phones, and there is a kind of trigger moment when you have a wallet installed, for example. And once you install a wallet, it's just making screenshots and stuff or whatever, and it's stored, so whatever, how safe, it doesn't matter how safe it is. And I mean, it can be complete bullshit, but at least it impressed me. And he said, somewhere when Bitcoin will be at a very high level, there will be one day, and it will hack everything in one time. But the moral of this story is that mobile phones are just not suitable for cryptocurrency, for example, because they are made to be an open device with all kind of communication and apps and stuff, and they're not a very secure medium, which I believe. So that, for me, is the reason I don't use a mobile phone. But what you do is you connect it to your computer, then you give in your PIN code, basically, and what you see is you get this screen on your computer, or on your mobile, of course, and this is scrambled all the time, so that's always different. So you just keep in your number. So it's malware proof in that way. Now, then you get, when you have, now talking Bitcoin, this is the screen you will see in the Trezor, in a ledger. It's about the same, but there you have an app, but it's always the same, where you have transactions or balance, a receive side tab and a send tab. And in most cases also that where you can sign and then verify. And you have compliance. You can see what your balance is and the transaction is good. I think this is, most people are familiar with this. When you want to receive something, but first, let's start there. When you receive, you just have a QR code that can be scanned or an address, and people send something to you. Now, how do you do it? You connect the device, open the app, enter the PIN number, select the receive tab, scan the QR code, close ready, check if the address is genuine on the device, and there you go. Then you receive it, you will see it in your balance. And when you want to send something, it's basically simple as well. And the same, you plug in an address, the amount, and you send it. Same thing, plug in, open up, PIN code, transaction, confirm. What you always need to do when you send, of course, is you need to confirm. That's basically because your private key is on the device, and it's just signing with the private key the transaction. And this will be then an encrypted format will be sent out via online. So your private key that gets yes in touch with the internet. Simple. Now, that's basically it, how these devices work. The other thing is, from time to time, you need firmware updates. I told you already, the best thing is, what you need to have is, you need to have your CP because something can go wrong, or another device as the backup. And of course, if you have the passphrase activated, you need that as well. With a chain split, like BC cache, Bitcoin cache, what you get in basically all cases, there will at least somewhere there will be a tool that will manage it for you. All the manufacturers will supply a tool to do the chain split. I think KeepKey didn't have one yet. But they will come up with some, with somewhere, I think it's more or less a no-brainer. You have to follow the procedure step by step and be very accurate, because something can go wrong, but if you do that, there's no problem. And always have, of course, your backups available. TrustSor, as we discussed already. And what you will get now is SegWit. Most people know about it. It's activated. Yeah, I should. It's not a chain split, I should say. It's a
other way of storing data on the blockchain.
Yeah, that's clear. But yes, but what you need for it is other, they have different addresses at least. So if you want to use SegWit addresses, then you have to transfer your firmware from the legacy to the SegWit to a SegWit address. At this stage, it doesn't make really sense. If you don't have a lot of transactions, it doesn't make sense either. I would say just leave it on the legacy system. But once you want to use SegWit, which in future with Lightning and stuff, I think that might become very interesting, then you have to transfer your funds to a SegWit address. But also, I think I saw already TrustSor has already a tool for it. It's, or at least it's the software is okay if you see it already. I saw already the difference over SegWit address, whatever. But they will take care of that. I mean, that's the, I think the end thing with these devices, more things are organized and quite well if you have these major changes.
What difference does it make from the key management address? What difference does it make?
SegWit? Nothing, it's just another address. And to make use of it, you need to send it. If you want to, in future, want to use, if you want to try and SegWit transaction or Lightning in future, you need to send it from a SegWit address. That's it. So just transfer funds.
Yeah, it could be advantageous to do sooner rather than later. Consolidating
your expense total as well, transaction fees are quite low. Yeah, exactly. The fees, that's another issue. So if you have a lot of transactions, then it might make sense as well already. Yeah. Because I think the legacy transaction fees went up as well lately, yes. Yeah. Okay. That's basically it for the cryptocurrency. There are some other things you can do with these devices. It's like signing messages. Someone doing that knows that word. Just a short explanation is, I'll just take one example. If you have an airdrop, for example, like a bike ball, and then you have to prove that you're owning Bitcoin.
then you can send them it. You can also sign it with this device, and you deliver basically the proof that you're the owner of Bitcoins, and then you get, in this case, free Bitcoin. Different other ways for us signing in. So it's basically a proving mechanism. Yeah? Good talk of that. These devices have the Bluetooth and FIDO integrated. I would like to use it, but just to on your side, because I hate to use the Google Authenticator, but the problem is most exchanges have no option to use it, because that's why where I really would like to use it is with the exchanges. Because exchanges don't give you the choice yet, at least, because they're, I think, for all the major ones. You can only use Google Authenticator or Authy or something, but you can use Q2F Firewall.
The only thing that I
can
imagine is just that it's really complex password, like 100 billion characters, okay, 64, and then put that in the process and then
Yeah, exactly. Maybe in future. For SSH connections, you can use it. For example, Ledger you can use to log in Windows, these type of things, several apps. And the Bitbox has an integrated key generator, for example. So if you want to generate addresses or keys manually, you can do it there. That's perfect planning. Another security, just apart from this, some other things you can do in security-wise is using a VPN. People are familiar with that, in particular when you're in an open wifi space, for example, because you can encrypt then the traffic from your computer to the VPN provider. And the other advantage is, for example, if you really get paranoia, maybe with reason already, then if you don't want people to know that you're using the resource or whatever, or exchanges, then they won't see that as well. Because they only see, your VPN server. So if you want to hide that, I think it's good for your identity protection policy. Okay, multisig. Most can be used. The Bitbox has it completely integrated already with the CoPay is an a wallet that's the only one used now, as far as I know, for multi-sig wallets. So you have multi-signature, and you have several devices you can use to some transactions. Told that already. You told that already. You told that as well. Advanced recovery is just what you now have to make a restore based on your seed. That's what it made easier in the device, so you don't. Basically, it's you call that you have that in the old phone as well. That it's when you just type the first two letters, and then it's auto-filling the whole word. So you can quite fast. You can do the recovery as well. So you just start the A, and then it filters all the available words. That's basically it. Just keep your coin safe, but I would recommend this to everyone. Use a hardware wallet in any case, or certainly, if it's a considerable amount, or substantial, I mean, that's of course very personal, but you think it's substantial. If you're worried about it, always, make sure you have a hardware wallet. Buy it direct from the manufacturer. Store your seed safely, use the PIN as long as possible, activate the passphrase, use plausible deniability, also for the customs, the government. And what I would do is practice a lot with the device as well and transactions, because I think there are many people who don't feel very comfortable. I think it's also kind of learning curve to feel for future. And just sending big amounts at once, you need to have some experience, that's what you want. And check the device, the accounts, and those on a regular basis.
That's it.
Thank you.
Any questions? First, I can go for coffee as well.
If you follow this hardware wallet, then you get two. If you put one in your computer and you do the use faster software to transfer bitcoins to it, is it also in the second hardware wallet at the same time?
Yeah, sure. Because it's
always nothing is stored on the hardware wallet. The hardware wallet is just in your keys. So it's just a transaction to the network, and it's not open.
Any questions?
People are tired, or I was clear.
Then we have another meeting, maybe we are going to right away, because we don't have any drinks here. It's a free meetup. Next time we might have it. But the guy is right behind the round building. It's right there. Can we see you there, Bob? Okay. Thank you.